let me get on to the topic of the day, because we have a limited time. We have a maximum, I think, of about an hour or so. And during that hour, I need to take you through a very, very long, but a very interesting journey, during which I wanted to really gain the maximum within this 1 hour that you spent with me today. Okay, so our topic for the day today is 5 ways to massive profits. Well, I know many of you all must be thinking that in this situation that we are stuck in today, profit is a word which probably is something that is, way off. Many of us are struggling to literally get some basic income in place. Then why this? Well, the top performers in business, or the top performers everywhere, they look at the future. They are forward thinking, they are optimistic. And that's what I want you to do. Because unless you have clear plans for the future, it's going to be difficult to get out of the situation today and then thrive in the situation tomorrow. So today's situation is about surviving, but we need to thrive tomorrow. So we need to put in place processes, we need to put in place systems that will help us to survive today as well as to thrive tomorrow. Okay. I have mentioned over here what is keeping your business from peak performance. By the way, I'd like each and every one of y'all to have a pen and a paper ready with you, and if possibly a calculator, but nowadays all of us use mobile phones as calculators, so I think calculator itself is not essential. But at least have a pen and a paper ready with you, because we're going to be doing some short activities also during the course of the session. So please make sure that you have this basic infrastructure. Okay, so what is keeping your business from peak performance? The assumption here is that there is a potential in your business and there is something that is keeping the business back. Now, every individual, every business has a potential. Potential is what you can actually achieve to the maximum. And there are various reasons why a person or a business is not able to achieve that potential. It could be to do with mindset, it could be to do with knowledge, it could be to do with skills, it could be to do with application of those knowledge and skills. We really don't have the time to go into all aspects of mindset and such things, but we'll definitely touch on a couple of tools and techniques that could help you to advance towards the potential that your business is capable of. Okay, yeah, a little bit of a technical issue. I was not able to advance the slide forward, but that's done now. Okay, so a key concept that we're going to be talking about today is time. Yeah, in business, your most valuable asset is time. So how many of you all agree with that? By the way, try and be participative. There is a chat box available. You can put in your comments in the chat box, and that will help me also to figure out what's going on and be able to respond at a later stage, because we'll keep a copy of that chat. Okay. So why is time the most valuable asset? Well, a lot of y'all must have heard about that old adage that you can manufacture money, but you cannot manufacture time. So every business owner has gone through ups and downs in their career, in their life. Sometimes they made extra money, sometimes they lost money, and so on and so forth. But time is a non-renewable resource. So let's say these 24 hours that are there with you, those 24 hours are fixed. Those 24 hours, once gone, cannot be returned. Yeah. So time becomes your most valuable asset. And the top business performers in the world, they ensure that they invest their time in activities which can give them the maximum ROI and the maximum ROE. What is ROE? Return on effort. So let's try and ensure that the next 40, 45 minutes or 50 minutes that you're spending over here gives you the best return on effort. Okay. Very often we get into that state where we try to be busy and we try to show that we are busy. And this is something maybe even cultural. Just being busy is not enough. Yeah. It's like, you know, you can be busy and not get any outcome. So being busy, doing the same thing again and again, getting the same results or no results is the definition of insanity. Yeah. What you need to do is ensure that you invest your time in activities which you as the owner are supposed to be doing. So for example, if it is an activity like, you know, following up with a vendor for some small supplies, that's not an activity which an owner should be involved in. Unfortunately, what happens with a lot of us in small and medium businesses is that we tend to get involved in every kind of activity. And we feel that unless we are involved in each and every activity, the business is not going to run. So we've got to be able to step back from that and ensure that we spend our time in activities that are highly value-added. Now, for example, an activity like this, where you're spending your time in learning some new concept, which you'll then be able to apply into your business, is a value-added activity for your business. So I'm going to reward the time that you're going to spend over here with some of the simplest, easiest, and the fastest ways to increase your income. Now, this is not theory. Sonali gave you some idea about Action Coach. Now, we as a group, as Action Coaches all over the world, we have about 1,000 coaches all over the world, and we're present in 80 countries. And on an average, we are coaching approximately 15,000 businesses every week. So all the concepts that we introduce to you, these concepts are distilled from the work that we actually do with clients. So these are not purely theoretical concepts. These are concepts which have actually been applied over the last 25 years to give clients solid business results. And this is what we present to you in our sessions. I'll give you an example, or let's say a couple of examples. So using some of the concepts that I'm going to introduce to you today, one manufacturer of scaffolding, one of our clients, achieved an increase in revenue of 42% and an increase in profit of 100% in a period of just 7 months. There was another client, which was a power equipment sales and service company. They increased their revenue by 25% in 6 months. Another company, which is a car servicing company, they increased their revenue by 265% and increased their revenue by 192%. And there are thousands and thousands of such case studies available. We can send you these case studies. What I'm trying to say is that the concepts that I'm talking about are not purely theoretical. These are concepts which will give you actual concrete results. Yeah. Okay. So what is the definition of a successful business? So I'd like you to put it in the chat box. What is your definition of a successful business? I'll give you, let's say, half a minute. Please put your ideas into the chat box. What you think is the definition of a successful business? So Kapil says it's recognition. Recognition for the owner. Vikram says a business which meets the aspirations of the owners. Shiva says good profits. Pankaj says generate profit with increasing capital. Majid says ability to retain clients. Interesting. Yeah. So we have different participants, assuming all of y'all are in business, who are giving the different viewpoints from profitability, from revenue, from the ability to retain clients, and so on and so forth. Yeah. Okay, so just a suggestion over here, one or two of you will have put it in the Q&A box. It'll be a good idea to just put it in the chat box so that everybody can see that. Yeah. Okay, so our definition, that is Action's definition of a successful business, and this is a definition that we have distilled over the 25 years that we've been working with business owners and taking their feedback about what is it that they really want to achieve in business. So through this feedback, we've come to the conclusion that a business can be called a successful business if that business is a commercial, profitable enterprise. We say commercial, so we have a separate procedure which we use for a non-profit organization. So here we're talking about commercial enterprises, which means a profitable enterprise. A commercial and a profitable enterprise that works. Yeah, a lot of our enterprises are really up and down and don't really work so smoothly. That works without you. So that's the key part in our definition of a successful business. It should be a commercial profitable enterprise that works without you. That means that works without the owner. Now, if you look at enterprises all over the world, within India or outside India, let's take, for example, enterprises within India. You look at the large conglomerates in India, you look at the Mahindras, you look at the Tatas, you look at the Birla Group. At some stage, all of them were small businesses. They wouldn't have started off at this level. And it is from that that they have graduated onto becoming such large conglomerates, which now work without the presence of the owner. So you don't have the Ratan Tatas and the Kumar Mangala Birlas and Anand Mahindras going to their business to make it work. They have teams, they have systems, they have processes, yeah? And they have structures which help the businesses to work without them and to grow, so that the owner is free to be able to do real activities and spend their time on real value-added activities, which would be, you know, talking about joint ventures, getting into new businesses, diversifying their business, hiring the right people, and so on and so forth. So that's the real job that the owner is supposed to do. And that is what our objective for a business is, to be able to create a business that works without you. And how would a business work without you? It would, if you work on your business and not in your business. So the objective is to be able to get you out of the business from the day-to-day operational challenges and hassles of your business, and be able to look at the business from an outsider, almost like a consultant. So that's how we work with business owners, is that we take them through an apprenticeship where, through coaching, we get them to look at a business from an outsider's point of view and put in place structures, processes, systems, so that the business can function without them. Okay. The keys to a business success. The top key to a business success is leverage. What is leverage? What is a lever? A lever is a tool that helps you to multiply your effort. All of us have studied this in school, in college, that a lever is like, for example, a crowbar. A crowbar is a lever. When do you use a crowbar? When, let's say, you've got to lift up a rock or move a rock, which is too difficult to do it on your own. So you multiply the effort that you apply on that rock by using this lever. Similarly, in business, leverage can be used by a business owner to expand the business multifold, to multiply their effort many times. And how do you do that? The various levers that are available to you as a business owner are your people, are your systems, technology, and sales and marketing. So through these four levers, you can expand or multiply the effort that you put in. So again, if you go back to the example of the large conglomerates that I was talking about, the Tatas and the Birlas and so on and so forth, they have number of people occupied in different organizations of their group. They have structures within those organizations, reporting structures, they have job description, everybody knows what needs to be done. They invest money in empowering the people, in training people, and that gives them that leverage so that, let's say, tomorrow one of the business owners decides to diversify into a business. All he needs to then do is put 10 people on the job to be able to do the analysis and so on and so forth. These people then need to be supported by the systems. What are these systems? For example, how often will board members meet? How often will the top leadership meet? What will they discuss during these meetings? What will be the methodology by which our people will be assessed, evaluated, trained, and so on and so forth? All these are systems and processes. You don't need to rethink them every time. And these are common systems which are spread across the various organizations. So it works automatically within that system. They say systematize the routine and humanize the exceptions. Only the exception should require human intervention. Rest, everything should be systematized. Yeah. A good example of that is a company like McDonald's. Yeah. You go into a McDonald's and you see the way the systems operate over there. These systems have then to be supported by technology. So you have ERPs. You have what we are using today through this technology of Zoom. We are able to communicate with our team members in various parts of the world, and we don't need that physical presence over there. So technology supports the system, systems support the people. And what supports everything else is the sales and marketing. Sales and marketing, that's the key activity which the business owner needs to indulge in. The business owner needs to be the rainmaker of the business. Unless revenue comes in, unless cash flow comes in, how would you invest that cash flow into the right people, into the right systems, into the right technology? So through these four levers, a business owner can create exceptional leverage and expand that build their business multifold. Yeah. So now I'm going to give you some concepts about how we can work on the lever of sales and marketing. Again, we have that 1 hour available today. There is no possibility in which I can take you through all the other levers, but I'm going to take you through one aspect of sales and marketing and how you can utilize that aspect as a leverage to expand your business multifold. Now, some people think of sales and marketing as an expense. How many of you think of sales and marketing as an expense? So if you go to your accountant will put this in the expense head. They would consider sales and marketing as an expense. But is it really an expense? The moment you consider it as an expense, then let's say, for example, the situation that you're in today. A lot of business owners are looking at cutting costs. And they would sit down with their teams and discuss, okay, which are the areas we can cut costs? And there would be a lot of suggestions which will come up saying, sir, you know, we are spending a lot of money on marketing. We are spending a lot of money on these promotional activities. We are spending money on advertising. Today, we're really in a difficult situation, and I think that's an area we should cut down. So today, we are spending money on human resources. We are spending money on developing our people and so on and so forth. We should cut our money there. Well, this is the worst thing that one could do today, is to cut expenses on sales and marketing, because today is the time when you really need more and more of marketing because you do not have the same level of interest that customers had prior to the crisis that we're going through today. So one has to change the mindset from marketing as an expense to marketing as an investment. This is our view, that marketing is an investment. Now, what is an investment? An investment is, the dictionary definition of an investment is putting in money and getting profit out of it. So if you invest 100 rupees and you get 120 rupees in return, the return on your investment is 20 rupees. So that's a 20% return on the investment that you put in. That's the dictionary definition or the financial definition of an investment. Similarly, in marketing, the money that you put into advertising, if it gives you a return, which means that let's say you spend 100 rupees on advertising, and in return, you get business which gives you a profit of 20 rupees over and above the money that you've spent on the advertising. So you get a return of 120 rupees. If you do get that, then that particular advertising or that particular marketing is an investment. And what do you do with that investment? You continue to invest as long as possible because it's giving you a positive return. Today, it's very easy to be able to measure this. And that is the reason why the mindset exists, and is because we do not do the measurement of this. So what we need to do is test and measure our sales and marketing. What do we mean by test and measure? 80% of advertising is not going to work. It's very difficult to second guess the customers. You really don't know what they're going to like and what they're not going to like. So you're going to have to create those promotions. You're going to have to create those marketing campaigns, put them out in the market and look at the response that you're getting. So you're going to have to put it out and test it, and you're going to have to measure the response. Today, luckily, in the digital medium, it's very easy to be able to measure that. So whether you put your advertising on Facebook or Google or wherever it is, it's easy to measure the response and be able to know what is the return you're getting on the investment that you're putting in. But even in the physical world, let's say on radio advertising or on advertising in newspapers or any other area of advertising, one simple way of being able to test and measure is that when you get a lead, when a customer approaches your business, one of the things that your salespersons or you as a business owner can do is to ask that customer, where exactly did you hear about us? So he may tell you that, you know, I attended this XYZ trade show which you have participated in. I met you in a networking event. I saw your advertisement in this magazine and so on and so forth. You've got to make a note of that. Why is that important? Because that is where you will come to know that these are the promotional activities which are really working and these are the ones which are not working. So for example, one of the business owners that we worked with, he was spending about 80,000 rupees every week on about five different media and five different forms of marketing and promotion. And we asked him that, you know, how long have you been doing this? So he said about a year. And what is your result? He said, you know, it's really not working. So sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't work. So I'm thinking of actually stopping this activity. So we said, hold on, let's do an exercise of test and measure for a couple of weeks. So we did that test and measure, and we found that out of those five activities, three of the activities where 80% of his advertising expenditure was going were not yielding any leads or results, which means that was a dead investment. And only two of them were giving good results, and they were giving really good results. So the simple thing was to take out the money from those activities which were not yielding any result and put it into the activities were actually delivering results. And within a matter of a week or 10 days, the number of leads that this person was getting increased by almost 100%, and then the conversions and so on and so forth. So that's the concept which is very important to keep in mind about sales and marketing, is that it's an investment. And to ensure that that investment is doing well, you need to consistently on a continuous basis test and measure. So there are two sides to marketing. One side is the acquisition cost. So the money that you spend on marketing is actually money you're spending to buy customers. So if you're spending, let's say, 30,000 rupees in advertising and you get 10 customers from that advertising which you put in, what you've done is, in a sense, paid rupees 3,000 to buy each customer. So our objective going forward in business has to be, how can we reduce this expenditure? And how do we reduce this expenditure? Well, that's something which I covered in the last slide, is by test and measure. So once we know that these are the areas which are actually giving us the maximum benefit in terms of advertising, we focus our expense on those particular areas and take out the money which is going on advertising or on marketing activities which are not yielding results. Yeah. So then our return becomes much higher and our acquisition cost per customer goes down. Now, to balance the acquisition cost is another concept called as the lifetime value. What is the lifetime value? So you bought a customer, you paid 3,000 rupees to buy a customer. So let's say you bought 100 customers. That means you paid 300,000 or 3 lakh rupees to get those 100 customers. Now those 100 customers should be able to give you the right kind of return. And that return comes from the lifetime value of the customer. How long the customer stays with you and how much that customer spends with you. So for example, let's take these customers which you bought for 3,000 rupees each. If they spend on an average 55,000 rupees a year for 6 years, then over their lifetime with you, they spend about 3,30,000 rupees. Yeah? And you paid 3,000 rupees to buy this customer. Now, even if your profit margin is 10%, I think it's more than paid for the advertising that you put into the customer. So that's the way one looks at sales and marketing as a investment rather than an expense. Okay. So how do we increase this lifetime value of a customer? Now, I'm going to introduce you to this powerful, powerful concept which we have used with businesses all over the world to be able to increase the amount of money that a customer spends with you over the lifetime and ensure that you get a better ROI on the money that you've spent in getting that customer, whether you've got that customer through a trade show, through, you know, digital advertising or any other form of advertising. Now, this is the formula for success in business in terms of profits and in terms of sales. So you may want to make notes on this. Your final profit comes from your revenue, very simple. Your profit margins on your revenue, which is the turnover that you do in your business, gives you your final profit. Where does the revenue come from? The revenue comes from the customers who spend money on you. So that is the average value of the order which a customer places on you. The average number of orders that a customer places on you over a period of a year. If you multiply that, so let's say a customer has X number of orders and you know Y average value, multiply that by the number of customers, that is the total revenue at the end of the year for you. Where do you get the number of customers from? It is the number of leads that you get. What are leads? Leads are the inquiries that you get. Customers who actually approach you, either on telephone, either on email, either they meet you personally or they approach your salespeople. Those are the customers that approach you into the conversion rate, which means the number of customers who actually get converted into buying customers. That is the total number of customers. This will be very clear when we see an example. So let's quickly go and see how this works in an example. Let's put in some numbers. So let's say the number of leads or the number of inquiries that you get in a year from existing as well as new customers is 4,000. So 4,000 customers approached your business. Let's say you and your salespeople, through the various techniques that you have, were able to convert 25% of these customers. So out of 4,000 customers, you converted 25% of them into actual people who placed orders with you. So that would come to a figure of 1,000 customers over a year who actually placed orders with you. Let's say these 1,000 customers, on an average, placed 2 orders with you over the year. Now, this is an average. It could be some customer would place 1 order, some customer would place 10 orders, and so on and so forth. Let's say the average value of that order which they placed with you was 10,000 rupees. Okay. So what is the total revenue of this business or the total sales that this business has done? It is the number of customers multiplied by the number of transactions they did in a year, multiplied by the average value of each transaction within this small and medium business is 2 crores. Yeah. And let's say the profit margin for this business was 25%. So the total profit of this business is 50 lakhs of rupees at the end of 1 year. Simple, straightforward. Now, a lot of you must be thinking that, you know, why are those three, parameters in red, customers, revenue, and profit? You may be thinking that these are the most important parameters. Well, these are not the most important parameters. These are the least important because these are the outcomes. You can't focus on customers, you can't focus on revenue, you can't focus on profit. What you need to focus on is the variables. Yeah. So what we're going to do is in between the, you can continue to put your questions on the chat. I'm not going to answer those questions right now. We'll do it at the end of the session. So we'll capture all those questions and we'll try and address a majority of those questions by the end of the session. So where was I? Yeah. So we end up with a profit of 50 lakhs in this simple business. Okay. Now, let's try and see how we can increase this profit. So our today's session is about massive profits, and massive profit has also to come through massive revenue or sales. So we're going to start seeing how we can increase this. Now, this is where I'm going to use the concept of leverage. Yeah. So let's try and see how we can increase this, let's say by 10%. Now, we're going to focus on the variables, which is the parameters in blue. And when the parameters in blue change, which is the number of leads, the conversion rate, and so on and so forth, the parameters in red would automatically change. So we're looking at a 10% increase in each of these parameters. Do you think 10% is possible? Well, actually, based on our experience, 10% is very, very conservative. Majority of the businesses that we work in and we work with, we are able to increase it far beyond 10%. So taking a conservative figure of 10%, let's see what happens to the profitability of this business. So number of leads, 4,000 leads, if we increase that by 10%, it would become 4,400. Yeah, 10% increase would be another 400 leads. That would become 4,400. We improve the conversion rate. Yeah, the people who actually buy from us from 25%, which means 1/4 of the customers, by 10%, and that 10% would not be 35%, it would be 27.5%. So we end up with how many customers? 4,400 leads into 27.5% would end up with 1,210 customers who actually bought from us during the year. Now, we'd also like to increase the number of transactions by 10%. Now, how do you think we can increase the number of transactions by 10%? By the way, you can put your comments in the chat again. What do you think are the ways by which you can increase the number of leads? You can increase the number of you can increase the conversion rate. You can increase the number of transactions, and so on and so forth. So as a hint, I will just give you a hint. For example, the number of leads, if you want to increase, a simple strategy like focusing more on your digital media, on SEO, a little more advertising, various different forms of advertising. Maybe you attend a trade show, participate in a trade show. We have in our portfolio almost about 80 to 85 different strategies to be able to just increase the number of leads. Normally, when we work with a business, we select the top 10 and then we work on improving those top 10. But please do put in your comments about what you think are the various methodologies by which we can increase the number of leads. Similarly, the conversion rate. Conversion rate is how well you convert those leads into actual customers, which means your selling. So your selling skills. So just training your people on selling skills, just flow charting your sales process and finding out where are the lacunae in the sales process, having better brochures, all these things can help you to improve your conversion rate. Yeah. Here again, we have about 50-55 strategies that we use to improve conversion rate. So that you end up with 1,210 customers just by increasing these two parameters by 10%. Now let's look at the number of transactions. Increase this by 10%. Again, what do you think you could do to increase the number of transactions? Well, you just look at something as simple as being in touch with your database. A lot of us in our business, we are not regularly in touch with our database. We do not send out a newsletter. We do not do follow-ups. We do not call up our customers regularly. Just the simple act of, on a consistent basis, being in touch with our customers. Sometimes we have a database where we have old customers who we've never been in touch with. Just this one simple strategy. Here again, we have about 60-65 strategies. Just this one simple strategy can easily help you to increase your average rupee sale by about 10%. So that'll go to 11,000 rupees. And you'll end up with a revenue of, so we've increased 10% in two or three areas. So do we end up with a revenue increase of 10%? No. We end up with a much higher revenue increase. And that is the power of leverage. It is a power of multiplication or leverage, multiplication of effort. So we put small effort in each of these four areas, and that yields us. You can do the calculation yourself and see if it is accurate. Now, this is a rounded off figure. So from 2 crores, we went to 2.9 crores revenue or sales, which is an increase of almost 46%. in this business. Similarly, we do it with the profit margins. Again, in the profit margins, we have another, 60 to 70 strategies. But any accountant will tell you that if your revenue has gone up by 46%, most likely your profit margin has already increased by about 10% because your fixed cost would not have gone up by that extent. But then again, there are strategies how you can reduce cost, how you can focus on higher margin items, and so on and so forth. Any of these strategies will help you to increase the profit margins by about 10%. So you will end up with a profit for this business at 80 lakhs. You can do the multiplication and check. Again, this is a rounded off figure. So the leverage has helped us through a small effort in these five areas. A 10% effort has given us a return of almost 60% plus in the final profitability figure. And that is how you're able to focus on getting higher profits and higher revenue in the business. Now let's look at some examples. So you get a 46% increase in your revenue and a 61% increase in your profit. So let's look at another example that if we do this by 30%. So I'll quickly take you through this. Now, if you've noted this down, you'll be able to do these calculations for your own business, and I'm going to tell you to do that also. So 30%, is 30% possible? Yes, of course it is possible. There are businesses in which we have, achieved 70%, 80%, and so on and so forth. It's possible that you may not achieve 30% across each and every parameter. In some parameter, you may achieve 70%, 80%, and some you may achieve 10%. But on an average, let's say if you do 30%, then you will end up with a figure of 5.7 crore from a 2 crore business. And you will end up with a profit of 1.85 crores. Now, these are not just pure profit. Now, here is what we are talking about, leverage, where we are actually multiplying it. Yeah. So almost three times, 300% and 350% plus in profits is what you're returning in this business. Yeah. Just for fun, if we increase it by 100%, each of these parameters, which is the ones in blue, we increase the number of leads by 100%, which means from 4,000 goes to 8,000, conversion rate from 25% goes to 50%. And by the way, there are people who look in the market for buying businesses, and this is the kind of figure they focus on. Will we be able to increase the business that we are buying? Will we be able to increase these parameters by 100%? Only if they can do by 80 to 100% is when they decide to buy the business, because then they can sell the business off for a really high value. So you increase this by 100% and you end up with figures like 32 crores in the revenue and 16 crores in your overall profit. Now, should we do something like 100%? Now, even if that is possible in your business, often we would recommend not to do this because, the amount of people you will need, the amount of cash you will need for this growth, the amounts of systems and processes you will need, it would need to be done in a very step-by-step fashion where, you're handheld by a mentor or a coach who helps you to manage this. Because if you're not able to deliver properly with this kind of a growth, that would create a problem. Yeah. But the possibility is there, is definitely possible. Yeah. So now what I'd like you to do is spend a couple of minutes. You have the formula here in front of you. Put these figures in for your business. So put these figures in, that the existing figures, what they are right now for your business, and what you would like them to be increased by, let's say, about 10%, and what they would be. So I'm going to give you a couple of minutes over here to do this exercise. Yeah. So if you have any doubts about this, just put it in the chat box. So if you're facing any challenge in doing this exercise, yeah, just put your query over there and we'll try and answer the queries later. Okay, so I'm assuming many of you would have been able to do a basic exercise. I know it's not easy if you don't have the exact figures. At this stage, what you would need to do is put in certain estimates, and later you can refine those estimates. But now that you have the formula in front of you, you can go and comfortably do this exercise later at your workplace. So let me go on with the presentation. So obviously for many of you, the next question would be that, is this really possible to do in my business? Well, my answer to that is, I really don't know. Because frankly, I do not know your business. So it's difficult for me to say what is possible and what is not possible in your business. But if you're really interested in finding out what is the potential of your business and how these numbers can be generated in your business, and to what extent can similar numbers be generated in your business, then what you can do is, and this is something that we are offering as part of this session, we will offer you a complimentary diagnostic session. It's like a business health check, where we will take you through these numbers specifically for your business. I've seen some of y'all have put it in the chat, very specific queries for your own individual businesses, somebody in a software business, somebody in another business. So we'll be able to take you through these numbers specifically for your business. Yeah. And if you're interested in that session, that's a complimentary session from our side. There's no cost to that. If you're interested, just put it in the chat box. You can put a D in the chat box. It'll indicate your interest in going for a diagnostic session. And we'll have a copy and a transcript of this chat. And we will then get in touch with you, fix up an appropriate time, an appropriate date to be able to do that diagnostic session. And what I will do during that session is, I will take you through these numbers specifically for your business. And then we will work out that how much is it that we can increase these numbers specifically for your individual business. Yeah. So put in a D in the chat box and we will be in touch with you for conducting that complimentary session for your business. Okay. So I know this slide is a little away from the hardcore numbers that we've been talking about till now, but it is very important for an entrepreneur and a businessman to dream. Why? All the top business persons in business and the top performers all over the world, they are big dreamers. They didn't let go of their dreams. Unless you dream about that future which you can attain, it is going to be very difficult to be able to approach that future. If you just think about only the present and the past, that's like driving a car by looking at the rearview mirror. That's not a good way to drive a car. Yeah, you've got to be able to see in front. For that, you need to have a clear vision, a clear goal for the future. And usually when we work with business owners, the first session that we do is about this session about dreams. What is it? So over a period of time, what happens with a lot of us is that we let go of our dreams because we don't have the tools and techniques to translate these dreams into actual reality. And that's something that we have. One simple process, which is not part of this session today, but I can tell you is what we use with business owners, is called DGLPA. What is that DGLPA? That's a bridge to translate your dreams into reality. What's the full form? Dreams, D, G, goals, L, learn, P, plan, and A, act. So take your dreams, translate them into specific goals, then find out what are the deficiencies that you have, what you need to learn to be able to actually achieve those goals. Learn that from sessions like this, then plan, create a very clear plan. So if it's a 5-year, 10-year dream, translate that into 3-year plans and then into 1-year plans. And what we do normally is what we call as a 90-day planning approach. And then act on it. Yeah. So don't forget your dreams. As Jim Rohn, a very, very respected mentor, says, never wish your life were easier. Wish that you were better. Work harder on yourself than you do on your job. So learn more and more. Work harder on developing your competencies, your technical competencies, your leadership competencies, your behavioral skills, and so on and so forth. And as you get to be a better owner or a better person or a better manager and a better leader, your business will improve because the business is a reflection of the business owner. Yeah. So now it's time for you to get into action. You picked up a lot of concepts and ideas today. It's time for you to put these concepts into practice and then give us feedback on how this is actually working in your business. I'm going to leave you with a concept which one of our global coaches introduced us to. And this is based on thousands and thousands of clients that have been coached and that have given feedback. The top performers that he discovered, this is one of our top 10 coaches in the world. The top performers in business he discovered had four C's as characteristics which differentiated them from others. And these four C's were, number one, they had a very clear idea about what they needed to do, which means they had clarity. Clarity about their future, clarity about their vision, clarity about their goals. They had a vision for the future, like the example of the car that I gave you. They knew exactly what the destination is, so they could literally press their foot on the accelerator and move in the direction that they wanted to. So complete clarity. Then they had complete conviction. That is the confidence, the self-confidence that the path they had chosen for themselves was the right path. And they put full energy behind that. And they had complete commitment, commitment towards themselves and commitment towards others. That is to keep to the promises that they've made. And this is where you may want to, I'm not trying to sell you coaching here, but if you Google it, you'll find that the top performers in the world, all of them have had coaches. It's a good idea to ensure that their commitments are kept to get a good mentor who can then ensure that you keep those commitments to yourself and to others. And the last C is courage. Because in business, you're going to have to make decisions which make you scared. You'll have that fear, that investment you're making, that new business that you're getting into, the new person that you're hiring. That fear will be there. But if the fear holds you back, you will not take action. And our company is called Action Coach because without action, this growth is not going to come. We can learn all the theories we want, but unless we actually take action on it, nothing's going to happen. So that's it from my side. Thank you so much. Now let's see if we can pick up some questions. Where is it? Yeah. So the last C, guys, is proactive courage. It is to be able to act despite the fear that you feel. Yeah. So every business owner feels fear at many times. But the top performers in business or in any other field, they go beyond that fear. And that requires courage. So top performers have courage. They're able to go beyond that fear. And this is where a good mentor can help you. Because you'll have doubts, you'll have self-doubts. And that is the time you can reach out to a mentor who can actually hold your hand at that time and be able to evaluate those doubts with clarity. Yeah. Another form of fear is FEAR, false expectations appearing real. Often, there is not so much reality, it is more in our head. Yeah. So Vikram is asking, the second C, Zakir, is conviction. Which means to be absolutely confident, to be absolutely clear. So once you've set a goal for yourself, a top performer is absolutely clear that, yes, I'm going to achieve it and is convinced in their ability. Here again, you can take the help of a mentor who can ensure that you retain that level of confidence to be able to go beyond your fears. Yeah. So Ankur is asking growth prospects for a digital marketing agency in 2020. I think exponential because it's becoming a little difficult for people to actually go out and meet people today. So, I think digital marketing is going to explode. Yeah, so it should be an exponential growth for you. Similarly with Pankaj with online education. Yeah, my wife is a teacher. She's learned so many things about Zoom. And she's teaching online, whereas she has a huge school infrastructure available to her, but she has to do it online. Yeah. Laundry business being a service industry post-COVID, why is it a big challenge, Kapil? You should be able to pivot yourself. So, for example, if I look at a laundry business, then let's say if you focus on a segment, which is a growth segment, which is the growth segment today, healthcare, every industry is going to have to wash their laundry, their security laundry, their people's clothes and so on and so forth more often. You know, sanitizing your PPEs. There are tools and techniques and there are machinery available for that. I don't know, there are so many options. You've got to be able to look for those opportunities. Every crisis has an opportunity, yeah? So Kapil, look for those. And if you're really keen, then put in a D over there and we'll have a short session with you and work out some ideas. Online education, yes. Aarti is asking, you have given clarity, confidence, courage. And fourth, Aarti, was commitment. You have to live up to your promises, to yourself as well as to others. That's very, very important. And living up to promises which you make to yourself is very important. Because if you fail yourself, then that confidence goes down and that conviction, see, goes down. Yeah. Are there any online business tools for business coaching? As a matter of fact, the majority of the coaching today is done online. Yeah. So, for example, we also have sessions which are like training sessions where we have a training course which runs for a period of about 4 months or so, where we impart a lot of knowledge to business owners, but that's not a one-to-one coaching. So the level of accountability over there for the coach is not as high as what would be there in a one-to-one coaching. Yeah, but we do have that kind of thing and that is done online, yeah, through webinars. Digital marketing, yeah. So I've mentioned all the C's again. I hope everybody has got that couple. The last C was courage, proactive courage. Yeah. How to generate urgent cash flow. Yeah, that's a major challenge nowadays. Cash flow is a big, that's a completely different and a new subject. But Prachi, you may want to look at everything from, obviously you're going to have to focus a lot on receivables. That's a big area you're going to need to focus on, and try and attend as many webinars and all as you can on receivables, how you can collect cash from the people who owe cash to you. You need to at the same time talk to your suppliers and vendors, because if you can get delayed payment terms from them, then obviously that helps your cash flow. And Prachi, focus on this five ways methodology which I have given you to look at the improving the top line, because this will give you cash flow. More customers coming in, more leads coming in, more leads getting converted means more customers, and more customers would mean more cash flow. Yeah. So various tools and techniques available. These are some of the things. How do you tailor learning for software services and software product sales? Vikram, we as coaches, we distance ourselves from the technicality of the business. We treat every business alike. For us, this is what we call as a business chassis. It's like a car's chassis. You can build any car on this. The chassis is the foundation. So this five ways is like a foundation. This can be applied to any business. And this foundation remains the same irrespective of business. It will only change if it is a non-profit organization. Yeah. So if it is an NGO, only then there will be some change. But for any business that is a profit business, it'll remain the same. Yeah. Shivali asking about customers who ask for installments and later become difficult for recovery. Shivali, we'll have to work on all the aspects of your sales process. That, you know, there are certain customers we do not want. So let's say I gave you one idea about the last one, how to improve margins. One of the strategies to improve margins is to categorize your customers into ABC categories. And if you have, rather even D categories, so you've got to get rid of those D category customers. Because dealing with a customer who is not profitable for you is a loss for you in terms of time, in terms of everything. And this starts from your sales process. your ability to, you know, get the right leads and be able to convert the right leads and so on and so forth. Yeah. So you will have to look at all those kind of areas. Yeah. Jayanti Rao, how do we add value to B2B? Now, again, the same chassis, Jayanti, applies to each and every business. You just got to split up your own business into this. So do this exercise for your business. And in case you face the challenge, get in touch with us and we'll have that one session with you. Yeah. So, okay, I'm putting here my contact number and my email address because some of you are asking for this. So I put it in the chat box. Vikram Bansal, any good books on this topic? Vikram, Brad Sugars, who is the CEO of Action Coach, founder of Action Coach, he has written a book called, I think, Instant Cash Flow. Yeah. And that book should be available on Amazon. And that has a lot of these ideas. Okay, yeah, sorry. So I put my contact details in all panelists. So let me change that to all panelists and attendees. Yeah, so there it is. Yeah. So guys, I think we are done with most of the questions. Sonali, you there?
Yeah, I'm there.
Okay. Okay. So what's next?
No, I think we'll just wrap up the session now. Thank you so much for such a wonderful session. I'm sure all the attendees had something to learn from this section. Thank you for being so patient and answering all their queries. And yeah, anything else you would like to say?
Yeah, so Sonali, I'll get a copy of this chat.
Yeah, of course. So all people who had put the D in for the diagnostic, I have copied all of that.
Okay.
So thank you so much to all our attendees also. We really hope you were able to add some value to your lives through this session. And thank you so much, Mr. Jaideep, once again for such a wonderful session.
Thank you, Sonali. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.